Tentor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Lee is Trapped and Must Be Taken, 11 Fateful Days After Gettysburg, July 4th to July 14th, 1863, by Thomas J. Ryan and Richard R. Schaus. Narrated by David Stifel. Prologue. After reviewing Thomas J. Ryan's masterful five-part series titled A Battle of Wits, Intelligence Operations During the Gettysburg Campaign, published in Gettysburg Magazine from 2003 to 2005, I concluded this was the best explanation I have read about the role of intelligence in the confrontation between General Robert E. Lee's Army of Northern Virginia and Major General Joseph Hooker's Army of the Potomac, later under the command of Major General George G. Meade, during the lengthy Gettysburg Campaign in 1863. I found each part of this series progressively more informative than the previous one. Ryan's background as a senior intelligence officer for the Department of Defense provided the knowledge and experience necessary to interpret the role of Colonel George H. Sharp as Chief of the Army of the Potomac's Bureau of Military Information, BMI. Ryan's work was a continuation of the pioneering study published by Edwin C. Fischel in 1996, titled The Secret War for the Union, The Untold Story of Military Intelligence in the Civil War. The information that the BMI provided to Meade during the battle, mainly derived from interrogation of prisoners of war, provided Meade with a better understanding of the strength and condition of Lee's army than General Lee knew himself. In concluding the five-part series, Ryan stressed that timely and accurate intelligence cannot affect the outcome of a battle unless it is coupled with resolute leadership. These Gettysburg Magazine articles formed the basis for Ryan's award-winning book, Spies, Scouts, and Secrets in the Gettysburg Campaign, How the Critical Role of Intelligence Impacted the Outcome of Lee's Invasion of the North, June to July 1863, published by Savas Beatty in 2015. Perceiving a need to expand on the analysis of the period subsequent to the three-day battle, during which Lee's Army of Northern Virginia retreated from Gettysburg, Ryan joined with co-author Richard R. Schaus to research and write about the decisions Lee and Meade made during Lee's desperate attempt to reach safety across the Potomac River after the defeat of his army at Gettysburg. On the fateful day of September 11th, 2001, I was walking through a shopping mall near my home, not far from the U.S. Department of Defense headquarters at the Pentagon in Arlington, Virginia. Suddenly, I heard the roar of an airplane flying overhead, followed by a tremendous explosion as the plane flew directly into the Pentagon. It has since occurred to me, had our intelligence agencies been as alert prior to 9/11 as the BMI was in gathering and reporting vital information about the enemy's intentions during the Gettysburg Campaign, and had U.S. authorities acted on that intelligence, that disaster may have been avoided. Keep this tragedy in mind as you hear Lee is Trapped and Must Be Taken, 11 Fateful Days After Gettysburg, July 4th to July 14th, 1863. A groundbreaking study that dissects those fateful days and the importance of the competing armies to both collect information about the enemy's location, strength, and intentions, and act upon that intelligence in a timely manner. Edwin C. Bars, Chief Historian Emeritus, National Park Service. Foreword. This is a deep study about decisions made by Army Commanders Major General George G. Meade of the Army of the Potomac and General Robert E. Lee of the Army of Northern Virginia during the aftermath of the Battle of Gettysburg in July 1863. General Meade had won a great victory over Lee at Gettysburg, July 1st to 3rd, 1863, And now the Confederate commander faced the exceedingly difficult job of withdrawing his battered army from the battlefield and southward across the Potomac River with as little additional loss as possible. Meade had to decide what his next steps would be in wake of his victory. The retreat was unique in many ways. The trek to the Potomac was more than 40 miles. Every day from July 4th to July 14th witnessed small unit actions and battles, including the fight at Monterey Pass in South Mountain on July 4th and 5th. There, Major General Hugh Judson Kilpatrick's Union cavalry attacked the advance of the Army of Northern Virginia. Kilpatrick suffered more than 40 casualties, and the Confederates lost in excess of 1,500, most of them taken prisoner. The clash sparked a chain of actions north of the Potomac over several days. On July 6th, Confederate Major General James Ewell Brown, Jeb Stuart's troopers, secured Hagerstown. This was an extremely important development because whoever held Hagerstown controlled the major routes to the Potomac. A battle unfolded there that was atypical of those fought during the Civil War. For much of the day, troopers, mostly cavalry, roamed up and down the streets fighting mounted and dismounted. Several times local civilians took up arms to fight alongside their favored side. Kilpatrick retreated back to Boonesboro and linked up with Brigadier General John Buford's cavalry division in an attempt to capture Williamsport, the site of several fords across the swollen Potomac. Confederate Brigadier General John M. Bowden and his cavalry brigade guarded a Confederate wagon train with about 10,000 wounded, stretching some 17 miles long. At Williamsport, in a desperate attempt to hold off Union cavalry under Buford and Kilpatrick, M. Bowden threw together a pickup team of diverse commands that included his own brigade, Maryland cavalry, and diverse infantry units that had been left behind to guard Lee's supply lines on the Virginia side of the river. Imboden even armed his teamsters as he formed a crescent-shaped defensive line around Williamsport. Holding it was critical to the survival of the Virginia Army. On July 7th, the opposing cavalry clashed at Funkstown, and on July 8th, Stuart struck Buford's and Kilpatrick's troopers in the fields north of Boonesboro with his entire division in an attempt to buy more time to help Lee's army to escape. The retreat is a compelling story. Jeb Stuart's cavalry division had an opportunity to prove their skill at both the tactical and operational levels. At the same time, Union cavalry came of age, sparring with rebel troopers and harassing Lee's exhausted columns. It is obvious just how important General Lee's retreat from Gettysburg was, but for more than a century, it was a mere footnote in the literature. One of the first attempts to seriously study the retreat in its entirety was Edwin Coddington's Gettysburg, A Study in Command, 1968. Coddington's final chapter offers context to the retreat in what was likely the first real effort to do so. The first book-length study of the retreat, however, was not written until 1978 with John Schilt's Roads from Gettysburg, which included first-hand accounts and human interest stories told by soldiers who wore both the blue and the gray, as well as civilians. In 1999, I had the honor to serve as guest editor for a special edition of North and South magazine on the retreat from Gettysburg. I wrote the lead article, 10 Days in July, an overview of the entire retreat. This issue went beyond Coddington by providing more detail on the tactical and operational aspects of those critical days. In 2005, Kent Masterson Brown's Retreat from Gettysburg, Lee, Logistics, and the Pennsylvania Campaign appeared. Brown spent years researching into collections that had never been used. Its major strength is its focus on the campaign's logistics, though Brown also has a firm grasp on the operational aspects. 3 years later, Eric Wittenberg, J.D. Petruzzi, and Michael Nugent came out with One Continuous Fight, The Retreat from Gettysburg, and The Pursuit of Lee's Army of Northern Virginia, July 4th to 14th. This excellent study was the first to fully grasp the tactical aspects of the retreat, and features a driving tour so listeners can trek on their own in the footsteps of the blue and gray. Lee's retreat was gaining interest with scholars. Enter Tom Ryan and Rick Schaus with Lee is Trapped and Must Be Taken, 11 Fateful Days After Gettysburg, July 4th to July 14th, 1863. This study is essential listening for students of the campaign. Ryan, a veteran of more than 30 years in intelligence work with the U.S. Army and Department of Defense, provides cutting-edge analysis of the retreat's operational aspects. Rick Schaus is a retired U.S. Army Sergeant Major who served in military intelligence assignments for more than 3 decades. Together, they have written the most important book on the operational and intelligence level of the retreat from Gettysburg that exists today. The bibliography reveals a galaxy of sources, rare books and articles, and seldom referenced collections from an extensive variety of repositories. A major and seldom used collection that undergirds much of the text is Army of the Potomac, Bureau of Military Information, BMI files at the National Archives. Using this and other collections, the authors tracked many Union spies and scouts working behind Confederate lines under the direction of the Colonel General H. Sharp, who led Meade's intelligence staff. This included operatives such as Sergeant Milton Klein, in my opinion, a Civil War period James Bond, who was active in covert operations that included disguising himself in a Confederate uniform, an act that would have resulted in his summary execution had he been captured. The authors also highlight the plight of some 4,000 Union prisoners forced to take part in the march back to Virginia. The POWs suffered from hunger and dehydration during the arduous trek. According to Captain William Porter Witkin, one of Kilpatrick's troopers captured at Hagerstown on July 6th, from that point on, food and drink was only available at irregular intervals. Ryan and Schaus also consider how local authorities and residents coped with the overwhelming aftermath of the battle in the small town of Gettysburg, and document the attentiveness and concern in communities across the country regarding the outcome of the battle in south-central Pennsylvania, and subsequent events as the armies trekked back toward the Potomac. The primary focus of this work, however, is on the decisions made by the opposing commanders, including Lee's efforts to maneuver under adverse conditions and communicate with the Confederate High Command in Richmond, and Meade's decision-making during the critical period after Gettysburg, especially regarding the Union Army commander's use and or misuse of timely intelligence that Colonel Sharp's BMI provided to him during these critical days. This book is unique in many respects and expands the historiography of the post-Gettysburg period while providing a comprehensive understanding of the factors that led to decisions made under considerable duress by the respective Army commanders. Congratulations to Tom Ryan and Rick Schaus for producing a masterpiece of scholarship. Ted Alexander, historian, retired, Antietam National Battlefield. Preface. Despite the publication of tens of thousands of books and scholarly articles, many important events of the Civil War have not received as much attention as they deserve. One of them is the immediate aftermath of the Battle of Gettysburg. President Abraham Lincoln and other authorities in Washington envisaged that the rebellion could be brought to an end after the Gettysburg victory if Meade pursued and crushed Lee's retreating army before it escaped across the Potomac River. This study evaluates how the Union commanding general marshaled his forces and employed the information he received from his intelligence staff, the Bureau of Military Information, BMI, during this complex contest with Lee. Our objective is to examine Meade's strategy and tactics, as well as his responsiveness to the desires and dictates of the Union authorities in the nation's capital. Unlike Lee, who had been at the head of the Army of Northern Virginia for a full year prior to undertaking the expedition into the North in early June 1863, Meade received an appointment to take command of the Army of the Potomac only 3 days before engaging in battle against Lee at Gettysburg. Meade had commanded combat troops about the same length of time as Lee. The primary difference between the two officers was that Lee's initial combat command was at the Army level, while Meade started out leading a brigade, then a division, and eventually a corps. Experience at lower levels afforded Meade valuable perspectives that Lee never acquired, and especially first-hand knowledge of small unit operations. At the same time, command of the Army level required special characteristics few generals possessed or exhibited during the Civil War. While Meade demonstrated certain of these qualities fighting on the defensive at Gettysburg, it remained to be seen how he would perform on the offensive in pursuit of the retreating but still very dangerous Virginia Army. The 3 days prior to Gettysburg, beginning when Meade assumed command of the Army on June 28th, and the three-day battle itself, were tests of the newly minted Army commander's ability to function under intense pressure while relying almost exclusively on his own judgment and expertise. Meade proved he was up to the task and mirrored the high standard Lee set in his first true role as Army commander during 7 days' battles on the Virginia Peninsula, June 25th to July 1st, 1862, where he defeated Major General George B. McClellan and drove his army away from the southern capital and back to the James River. Lee is trapped and must be destroyed is a sequel to Spies, Scouts, and Secrets in the Gettysburg Campaign, how the critical role of intelligence impacted the outcome of Lee's invasion of the North, June to July 1863, which set forth the story of Lee's expedition into the North and the eventual confrontation between two armies at Gettysburg in south-central Pennsylvania. Among other things, that study demonstrated how hard it was for Lee to maneuver his Army of Northern Virginia effectively without the services of Major General James Ewell Brown, Jeb Stuart, and his cavalry division, Lee's principal intelligence-gathering component. The separation was the result of actions taken by Major General Joseph Hooker, the commander of the Army of the Potomac at that time, in response to intelligence he received regarding the movement of Lee's army. The Union moves ended up separating Stuart from the main Confederate army at a critical time. Lee later acknowledged that Stuart's absence much embarrassed, that is, handicapped, his efforts at Gettysburg. Conversely, Meade's intelligence staff, the BMI, under Colonel George H. Sharp, kept him very well informed about the location, strength, and intentions of Lee's army. Sharp's reports impacted subsequent events, and in particular the fighting on July 3rd. As will be seen in the forthcoming analysis contained in this book, the intelligence resources of both armies were active in the aftermath of Gettysburg. A battle of wits raged during those 11 fateful days to determine which commander understood and would properly apply the information he received to gain the advantage over his opponent. Thomas J. Ryan, Bethany Beach, Delaware. Richard R. Schaus, Capon Springs, West Virginia. Introduction. The commander of the Army of the Potomac's 5th Corps, Major General George G. Meade, was rudely awakened in his tent at 3 a.m. on the morning of June 28, 1863. The Union Army was in the vicinity of Frederick, Maryland, and had spent the last 3 days crossing north over the Potomac River from Virginia in pursuit of General Robert E. Lee's Army of Northern Virginia, which was understood to be marching through Maryland and Pennsylvania. Unbeknownst to Meade and the Army's other senior officers, their commander, Major General Joseph Hooker had sent a request to General-in-Chief Henry Halleck in Washington that I may at once be relieved from the position I occupy. Halleck and Hooker were at loggerheads over the disposition of nearly 10,000 troops manning an outpost at Harper's Ferry. Hooker wanted them incorporated into his army. Halleck denied his request. Hooker was also exhibiting signs of stress under the burden of confronting Lee's army again after being soundly defeated at the Battle of Chancellorsville in early May. Provost Marshal Marcinaw Patrick, whose organization was responsible for providing intelligence about the enemy, noted Hooker's recent erratic behavior in his diary and summed up the situation in uncompromising language. "We get accurate information, but Hooker will not use it and insults all who differ from him in opinion. He has declared that the enemy are over 100,000 strong. It is his only salvation to make it appear that the enemy's forces are larger than his own, which is all false, and he knows it," wrote the frustrated Patrick. "He knows that Lee is his master and is afraid to meet him in fair battle." The task of rousing Meade out of bed at that early hour fell to Lieutenant Colonel James A. Hardy, the messenger of Secretary of War Edwin Stanton and General Halleck. The first words from his mouth startled Meade. "I have come to give you trouble." The general thought he was being relieved of duty or being placed under arrest. Neither possibility was out of the question. Hooker and Meade had been engaged in open war over whether Meade had voted to withdraw the army back across the Rappahannock River at Chancellorsville. Instead of being relieved or arrested, however, Hardy delivered a letter appointing Meade as the new commander of the Army of the Potomac. Hardy, who had traveled by train from Washington in civilian clothes to maintain secrecy, continued in his awkward assignment of a lower-ranking officer engineering a sensitive transfer of power by accompanying Meade to Hooker's headquarters. The commotion awakened Meade's staff aides. One of them was Meade's son, Captain George Meade, whose father told him to come along. The little party, Meade, son George, and Hardy, rode silently along, the conversation almost restricted to a few questions asked by General Meade, who seemed deeply absorbed in his own thoughts. Until, recalled the young captain, headquarters being reached just after daylight, he was ushered into the tent of General Hooker, who was apparently ready to receive him. Hooker, who knew, or at least suspected, that he had lost the confidence of the Union hierarchy in the Capitol, accepted the change of command graciously. The turnover went forward without fanfare, and Hooker briefed Meade on the current situation. Captain Meade, who had waited outside unaware of what was taking place in Hooker's tent, related what happened next. The interview between Generals Hooker and Meade lasted for some time, when the latter issued from the tent and called to me, his aide, with a familiar twinkle of the eye, denoting the anticipation of surprise at information to be imparted. He at last quietly said, "Well, George, I am in command of the Army of the Potomac." Lieutenant Colonel Hardy, who had fulfilled the most important part of his uncomfortable responsibility, wired Halleck, who, along with President Abraham Lincoln and Stanton, eagerly awaited the outcome. "I have accomplished my mission." Before taking his leave from the Army, Hooker wrote a farewell note to the troops. General Orders No. 66 exhibited no sign of past disagreement with his successor. "In conformity with the orders, I relinquish the command of the Army of the Potomac. It is transferred to Major General George G. Meade, a brave and accomplished officer who has nobly earned the confidence and esteem of this army on many a well-fought field." Hooker acknowledged that his usefulness as the commander of the Army of the Potomac is impaired, but was confident that the courage and devotion of this army will yield to my successor a willing and hearty support. Once that message was released to the troops, Hardy telegraphed Halleck that the formal issue of the order of the late commander had been made, and that he had taken the pulse of the feeling and internal condition of the army. Hardy's conclusion was there was cause for satisfaction, and he was returning to headquarters that night. Meade's advancement, especially when considering that only 1 year earlier he was leading a brigade of Pennsylvania reserves, was rather dramatic. The new army commander had little time to contemplate or celebrate what had just occurred. 4 hours after receiving this unanticipated news, he responded to Halleck that he would obey his directive to the utmost of my ability. Even after Hooker debriefed him prior to his departure, Meade remained concerned that he lacked knowledge of the exact condition of the troops and the whereabouts of the enemy. He planned to move his troops toward the Susquehanna River while keeping Washington and Baltimore well covered, as specified in the orders he had received that morning. Halleck's message appointing Meade spelled out the Lincoln administration's expectations of the new Army of the Potomac commander. You will not be hampered by any minute instructions from these headquarters. Your army is free to act as you may deem proper under the circumstances as they arise. You will, however, keep in view the important fact that the Army of the Potomac is the covering army of Washington, as well as the army of operation against the invading forces of the rebels. You will, therefore, maneuver and fight in such a manner as to cover the capital and also Baltimore, as far as circumstances will admit. Should General Lee move upon either of these places, it is expected that you will either anticipate him or arrive with him so as to give him battle. This twofold requirement, engage Lee while protecting the capital and Baltimore, as far as circumstances will admit, would lead to some differentiation between Meade and President Lincoln over its interpretation. Once he acknowledged his appointment, Meade issued General Orders No. 67 to inform the officers and men of the Army that the President had appointed him to replace Hooker. He spelled out the situation as he understood it. The country looks to this Army to relieve it from the devastation and disgrace of a hostile invasion, he explained. Whatever fatigues and sacrifices we may be called upon to undergo, let us have in view constantly the magnitude of the interests involved, and let each man determine to do his duty, leaving to an all-commanding providence the decision of the contest. As this story unfolds, it will become evident the new commanding general's depiction of Lee's expedition into the North as a hostile invasion reflected a fundamental difference between his and Lincoln's strategic outlook regarding the military struggle underway in the country. This difference would soon manifest itself in the planning and execution of the Army's operations. Meade redirected the Army of the Potomac after news arrived that Lee's army was concentrating about 40 miles east of the Susquehanna River, just north of the Maryland line. The new Army commander had sent two brigades of Brigadier General John Buford's Cavalry Division northward on a scouting mission. When they arrived in a small town named Gettysburg on June 30th, elements of Lee's army were discovered descending on that area from three directions. Meade ordered two of his seven Army Corps, 1st Corps and 11th Corps, to march to Gettysburg. Both corps moved to the vicinity of Emmitsburg, Maryland, with Major General John Reynolds in command of Meade's left wing, 1st, 3rd, and 11th Corps. Buford's report prompted Reynolds to march to Gettysburg with dispatch, with his own 1st Corps in the lead, followed by Major General Oliver O. Howard's 11th Corps. The cavalry was fighting a delaying action on the ridges west of town when 1st Corps arrived. Reynolds hurried the men cross-country to confront the leading elements of Confederate Lieutenant General A.P. Hill's 3rd Corps. Soon thereafter, advance elements of Lieutenant General Richard Ewell's 2nd Corps were discovered coming in from the north. Howard's 11th Corps men rushed through town and deployed to meet Ewell. So began the consequential battle at Gettysburg on the morning of July 1st. In order to understand Meade and Lee as Army commanders, it is important to examine their backgrounds and experience level. Meade assumed control of the Army of the Potomac on only 3 days before a major battle. He had 2 years of command and combat experience at the brigade, division, and corps level. Lee assumed command of the Virginia Army only after its beloved commander, Joseph E. Johnston, fell with a critical wound during the Battle of Seven Pines on May 31, 1862, with the Army of the Potomac just outside Richmond. He had led Virginia forces in western Virginia early in the war and was defeated in the small Battle of Cheat Mountain in September 1861. Thereafter, he oversaw the Department of South Carolina, Georgia, and Florida, and the construction of its coastal defenses before being transferred to Richmond to serve as a military advisor to President Jefferson Davis. By the time the Gettysburg Campaign got underway in early June 1863, Lee had been in command of the Army of Northern Virginia for a full year. Meade's exposure to combat in command of three different combat organizations, a brigade, division, and then 5th Corps, familiarized him with tactical operations at those levels. Lee's assignment as Army commander allowed him time to get comfortable with strategic and operational planning. There are other factors to consider. During the previous 2 years of war, Meade had been a keen observer of commanding generals George McClellan, Ambrose Burnside, and Joseph Hooker, as well as a sharp critic of their decision-making during combat situations, to the point of specifying how he would have acted differently. Lee had recently lost trusted subordinate and Corps commander Lieutenant General Thomas J. Stonewall Jackson, who had been mortally wounded at Chancellorsville 2 months earlier. Jackson's death prompted Lee to reorganize the Army of Northern Virginia that May from 2 Corps into 3 Corps. As a result, 2 of his 3 Corps commanders, Hill and Ewell, were new to the job when the Army marched north in June. Logistically speaking, the transfer of the armies from Virginia to Pennsylvania benefited the Army of the Potomac because it was closer to its source of supply. The Army of Northern Virginia had to carry ordnance and other supplies along with it in a lumbering train of wagons while foraging locally to feed the Army. Meade left his headquarters in Taneytown, Maryland, and arrived at Gettysburg during the early morning hours of July 2nd, after a day-long battle and heavy casualties on both sides. Reynolds was dead, 1st Corps and 11th Corps had been wrecked, and the Army driven back to higher defensible terrain southeast of town. Meade decided it was a good place to make a stand, and the balance of both armies marched for Gettysburg. Lee attacked both ends of Meade's line on the second day. By the time the sun had set, Meade's army had suffered some 20,000 casualties thus far, and Lee's about 13,000. July 3rd witnessed more bloodletting, most of it shed by the Confederates, on the slopes of Culp's Hill, on East Cavalry Field, and during Longstreet's assault, popularly known as Pickett's Charge, against Cemetery Ridge. Another 10,000 rebels added their names to the casualty list, as did some 3,000 Union soldiers. Because the total casualties for the 3 days were roughly identical, the Northern Army was left with a 22,000-man superiority. Meade, however, could anticipate the arrival of reinforcements. None would be available to augment Lee's army. When Lee withdrew from the field at Gettysburg on July 4th, news of Meade's victory over the previously invincible rebel general spread throughout the northern states and turned the Union commander into a national hero. Another task, however, already loomed for Meade that might prove even more daunting than standing firm on defensible ground and fending off attacks. The authorities in Washington envisioned an end to the war, and that it could be accomplished by destroying Lee's army above the Potomac. In order to achieve this objective, Meade was expected to overtake and engage the Army of Northern Virginia before it could reach the relative safety of the south side of the river. This audiobook describes how Meade carried out this mission, and the moves Lee undertook to prevent being trapped and destroyed in Maryland. Who was George G. Meade? Some observers describe him as a valiant Union commander who defeated the formidable General Lee at Gettysburg. Edwin B. Coddington examined the public's perception of Meade as a military leader and concluded that, despite widespread criticism that he was not up to the job as the commander of the Army of the Potomac, the country was indebted to him for what could have been a disaster if Gettysburg had been lost. Meade is the Rodney Dangerfield of Civil War generals. He gets no respect, concluded a more recent writer. George Gordon Meade may have won the Battle of Gettysburg, but it seems he lost the War of Reputation to Lee. Lieutenant Frank Haskell, an aide to Brigadier General John Gibbon at Gettysburg, described Meade as a tall, spare man with full beard, which, with his hair, originally brown, is quite thickly sprinkled with gray. The general, continued Haskell, has a Romanish face, very large nose, and a white, large forehead, prominent and wide over the eyes, which are full and large, and quick in their movements, and he wears spectacles. His fibers are all of the long and sinewy kind. His habitual personal appearance is quite careless, he added, and it would be rather difficult to make him look well-dressed. He was a peculiar man, in many ways, one not constituted to command attention, wrote veteran Union cavalryman Joseph Kirby. He was evidently conservative, and perhaps too cautious, but when one recalls that he had won a great victory, and in forcing a second battle unprepared, he not only staked his hard-earned laurels, but he risked the army and the capital. Kirby, a member of Brigadier General H. Judson Kilpatrick's division, thought Meade every inch a soldier, as well as a gentleman by birth and training. In camp, he was the most unpretentious looking of the general officers. His spectacled face, rather quiet, scholarly bearing, reminds me of professors or doctors whom we frequently see. They resemble him in appearance. Unlike many generals, he always wore a slouch hat, and around his neck was invariably worn the old-fashioned leather stock, used in the regular army on recruits to keep their heads checked up. These generally favorable views of Meade were contrasted by Assistant Secretary of War Charles A. Dana. He was a tall, thin man, rather dyspeptic, I should suppose from the fits of nervous irritation to which he was subject, observed Dana. He was totally lacking in cordiality toward those with whom he had business, and in consequence was generally disliked by his subordinates. As a commander, Meade seemed to me to lack the boldness that was necessary to bring the war to a close. He lacked self-confidence and tenacity of purpose, he continued, and he had not the moral authority that Grant had attained from his grand successes in other fields. As soon as Meade had a commander over him, he was all right, but when he himself was the commander, he began to hesitate. Colonel Regis de Trobriand, a brigade commander in the Army of the Potomac's Third Corps, also had sharp observations of Meade, which he set forth in his 1889 memoirs, 4 Years with the Army of the Potomac. During the Gettysburg Campaign, he opined Meade was not one of those formed to take the ascendancy over men by that greatness of character for whom power is an easy instrument and who appear born to command. De Trobriand thought that, although his personal valor and his military capacity were incontestable, Meade was more reserved than audacious, more modest than presumptuous, on which account he treated his corps commanders rather as friends than as inferiors. As far as de Trobriand was concerned, Meade's lack of audacity and proclivity toward collegiality were not a formula for assertive tactics and risk-taking. While there are similarities in the descriptions of Meade's appearance and demeanor, they differ in how they view his qualifications to command an army. This reflects the present-day view of Meade that is often at a loss to pinpoint his overall capabilities, as well as his place in history. From an operational perspective, we know what Meade thought about the role of one army commander prior to his taking control of the Army of the Potomac. As noted earlier, as a brigade, division, and corps commander, Meade was outspoken and at times critical of Generals McClellan, Burnside, and Hooker. A common theme runs through critiques of his superiors, especially with regard to their lack of aggressiveness in combat and moral authority shortcomings. Meade's performance during the run-up to the battle at Gettysburg demonstrates that he worked hard to avoid repeating mistakes he attributed to his predecessors. He acted assertively after replacing Hooker on June 28th. Although disgruntled subordinates attempted to demean his performance leading up to and including the battle itself, most objective observers see their behavior and criticisms as self-serving. Meade was much more cautious in his approach to command regarding the pursuit of Lee after Gettysburg, which brings to mind his thinking following the Battle of Antietam in September 1862. "I feared at one time the movement of McClellan's forces from Washington to intercept Lee's withdrawal into Maryland was a dangerous one. For if we were defeated and this army broken up, the country was gone," he later explained. Rather than have McClellan pursue Lee after the combat at Antietam to inflict further damage or destroy his wounded army, Meade believed that the country, Washington authorities, ought to let us have time to reorganize and get into shape our new lines and then advance. Prior to taking command of the army, Meade's strategic thinking fluctuated between a conservative and an offensive-minded approach. Despite his hesitance about intercepting Lee, or resting and reorganizing the army prior to any pursuit after Antietam, Meade criticized McClellan after that battle by complaining, "He errs on the side of prudence and caution, and that a little more rashness on his part would improve his generalship." On January 2, 1863, less than 3 weeks after the disastrous Battle of Fredericksburg, Meade confided to his wife that he was still in favor of making an attempt to whip the enemy. "He placed himself among the fire eaters," he told her, "because I am tired of this playing war without risks." With General Burnside in mind, the division commander unequivocally stated, "We must encounter risks if we fight, and we cannot carry on war without fighting." McClellan also had this vice, argued Meade, because he was always waiting to have everything just as he wanted before he would attack. "Such a general," he concluded, "will never command success, though he may avoid disaster." On March 15th, after his promotion to command the Army of the Potomac's Fifth Corps, the frustrated husband informed his wife that the choice should be to carry on the war as it ought to be, with overwhelming means, both material and personal, or else give it up altogether. "I am tired of halfway measures and efforts, and of the indecisive character of operations up to this time," and desired a vigorous prosecution of the war with all the means in our power. Meade often penned confidential letters to his wife, and he did so again on March 30, 1863, about the fate of Major General William B. Franklin, on whom Burnside laid blame for the Army of the Potomac's defeat at Fredericksburg. Franklin, argued Meade, was hampered by his orders and a want of information as to Burnside's real views and plans. However, he emphasized, "A great captain would have cast them aside and assumed responsibility." After the Army of the Potomac's devastating and humiliating defeat at the Battle of Chancellorsville in early May 1863, Meade once more confided in a private letter to his wife on May 8th that Army Commander Hooker was more cautious and took to digging quicker even than McClellan, thus proving that a man may talk very big when he has no responsibility, but that it is quite a different thing acting when you are responsible and talking when others are. 2 days later, on May 10th, the general lamented, "All I can say is that Hooker has disappointed the army and myself in failing to show the nerve and coup d'oeuvre at the critical moment, which all had given him credit for before he was tried." Hooker, Meade believed, acted sincerely, and for what he considered the interests of the army and the country, but I differed with him in judgment, and I fear events will confirm my view. I was clearly in favor of tempting the hazard of the die, going on the offensive, and letting Washington take care of itself. The army commander has on this occasion missed a brilliant opportunity of making a reputation for himself. Protecting Washington at the expense of battlefield tactics had been an issue since the first days of the war, and it raised its head once again following the Chancellorsville defeat. Hooker made a concerted effort to lay blame on others for the humiliating loss to Lee's much weaker army, and claimed that Meade voted in council to withdraw the Army of the Potomac from the battlefield. The accusation angered the Fifth Corps commander, who adopted a tough stance on the issue in a heated discussion with Hooker. "My opinion was clear and emphatic for an advance," he argued, "and I had gone so far as to say that I would not be governed by any consideration regarding the safety of Washington, for I thought that argument had paralyzed this army too long." Further, Meade insisted, "If the enemy were considered so strong that the safety of the army might be jeopardized in attacking them, then I considered a withdrawal impracticable without running greater risk of destroying the army than by advancing." Meade concluded the Chancellorsville loss ultimately stemmed from the caution and prudence exhibited by General Hooker at the critical moment of the battle, at his assuming the defensive when I thought the offensive might have been assumed, and at the withdrawal of the army to which I was opposed. Hooker's battle plan was admirably designed, conceded Meade, but instead of striking at once, vigorously and instantly, before the enemy, who were surprised, could concentrate, he delayed and assumed the defensive and withdrew. Ironically, Meade believed that General Lee had also made a serious mistake. The Confederate leader, he claimed, committed a terrible blunder in allowing us to come back. He might have destroyed us by a vigorous attack while we were retreating. While progressing through the various ranks, Meade took the measure of his superiors and often found their personal behavior and decision-making less than satisfactory. When he was thrust into the command of the Army of the Potomac on June 28, 1863, there was little time to conjure doubts designed to constrain assertiveness. The enemy was marching across south-central Pennsylvania and had to be intercepted and beaten. Meade had the opportunity to implement the strategy and tactics he envisioned as a subordinate officer. His defensive display at Gettysburg was a tremendous military victory over a vaunted opponent. Now his decision-making as an army commander was about to be further tested against that same enemy during the post-Gettysburg period. In the following chapters, we examine Meade's plans, objectives, and leadership, as well as the morale, expectations, movements, and performance of the Army of the Potomac during the 11-day period from July 4th to July 14th. Chapter 1, July 4th, 1863. The Union Army's task is not yet accomplished. A retreat always gives an advantage to the pursuing army, and this is particularly the case after a defeat and when the source of supplies and reinforcements is at a great distance, for a retreat then becomes more difficult in proportion to the skill exhibited by the enemy in conducting the pursuit. Baron de Jomini. In a lost battle, the power of an army is broken, the moral to a greater degree than the physical. A second battle, unless fresh favorable circumstances come into play, would lead to a complete defeat, perhaps to destruction. Karl von Clausewitz. The bloody three-day Battle of Gettysburg ended in a decisive tactical Union victory on July 3, 1863. General Robert E. Lee's offensive attacks on July 1 crushed and routed two enemy infantry corps and captured large numbers of Union soldiers and supplies. Success, however, proved elusive over the next 2 days, and especially on the last afternoon, when Lee's attack against Major General George G. Meade's center was repulsed. Lee's heavy losses made a strategic retreat both necessary and extremely dangerous. Lee conferred with his corps commanders on the evening of July 3rd and issued general orders to begin a strategic withdrawal. The army will vacate its position this evening. The commanding general earnestly exhorts each corps commander to see that every officer exerts the utmost vigilance, steadiness, and boldness during the whole march, read part of the order. The reversal of fortune left Lee with only two feasible escape routes from Gettysburg, Chambersburg Pike and Hagerstown, Fairfield Road. Lieutenant General A.P. Hill's Third Corps commenced the movement, followed by Lieutenant General James Longstreet's First Corps. Lee's Second Corps under Lieutenant General Richard Ewell brought up the rear. Lee assigned Major General James Ewell Brown, Jeb Stuart's Cavalry Division, to precede the army and guard its flanks and rear. The Army of Northern Virginia would march through Fairfield, over the mountains into Waynesboro, continue through Hagerstown, and finally cross the Potomac River near Williamsport, Maryland. Lee knew that crossing over onto the much safer and friendlier southern side would offer more protection and better supply line capabilities. The detailed instructions Lee provided to Stuart, particularly where to place the bulk of his cavalry, indicates that he expected the greatest enemy threat to come against his army's exposed left and rear. Lee expected the new Army of the Potomac, AOP commander, to move southwestward, following the Virginia Army onto a roughly parallel route toward the Potomac River. Lee was aware Meade had limited options available to him because the defense of Washington had to also be factored in due to well-known anxiety of the Northern government for the safety of its capital. Once he took command of the AOP, the initial orders sent to General Meade from General-in-Chief Henry W. Halleck assigned dual missions: the covering Army of Washington, as well as the Army of Operation against the invading forces of the rebels. Lee also ordered a lengthy wagon train to be sent toward the Potomac under the command of Brigadier General John M. Bowdoin and his Roughneck Brigade of 1,300 horsemen. The 17-mile-long serpentine procession included assorted vehicles jammed with thousands of wounded troops, as well as critical quartermaster, subsistence, and ordnance supplies. The cavalcade of misery began around 4 p.m. that afternoon. One conveyance transporting wounded rebels was a single horse-drawn buggy with Colonel Eppa Hunton and Lieutenant Colonel Norman Berkeley. Both officers from Brigadier General Richard Garnett's brigade were wounded on July 3rd during Pickett's charge. Hunton was struck advancing toward the Kodori barn, and Berkeley went down once he had reached it. The injured colonels described their perilous trip to the Potomac as tedious and agonizing, particularly since neither had any food except wax cherries plucked from a tree along the route. Other officers in the procession included Captain George Clark of Company B, 11th Alabama, who shared a wagon fitted up as a kind of ambulance with Colonel John C. Saunders and Major R.J. Fletcher. Despite Union cavalry attempting to cut down some ambulances along the route, the bulk of the wagon train survived its journey to the Williamsport crossing. Lee ordered his retreating army to travel along a different route in order to cross the Potomac at Williamsport in Falling Waters, 4 miles farther south. Lee had left a pontoon bridge at the latter place after his army crossed during its trip north. 1st New York Cavalry, under Colonel Andrew T. McReynolds, notified Major General William H. French at Frederick, Maryland on July 3rd that the rebel force in the vicinity of Williamsport was small and 150 cavalrymen could destroy the bridge. Its destruction was especially important since the bridge was the only reliance of the rebels for a retreat for their infantry, artillery, and wagons in that direction. French, who was told by Meade to annoy Lee as much as possible and sever his communications, readily agreed to send a detachment of 300 horsemen from Major Shadrach Foley's 14th Pennsylvania Cavalry to perform the task. According to French, his orders were issued immediately upon hearing cannon fire at Gettysburg on July 3rd. If true, the directive from Meade was an extremely alert and assertive decision on the part of a general with a reputation for being cautious and slow to react. Lee knew a vigilant and orderly retreat across the Potomac was needed if they hoped to arrive safely on the other side of the river without suffering additional losses. Traveling with the rebel army, Savannah Republican correspondent Peter Wellington Alexander wrote a dispatch describing the scene on July 4th. "Today, all has been quiet along the lines. General Lee has endeavored to provoke the enemy to make an assault upon his position by throwing his skirmishers forward," explained Alexander. "But General Meade, who has displayed much skill and judgment, is too well aware of the strength of his own position and the madness of attacking Lee." A graduate of the University of Georgia, Alexander had worked as an attorney and newspaper editor before choosing a career as a war correspondent. Though a loyal Southerner, he never hesitated to criticize perceived failures by the government or by the military. For example, he ventured into the precarious waters of assessing Lee's command performance on July 3rd by expressing his belief it would have been better if the attack had been delayed by a day. He believed the delay would have allowed time for a careful reconnaissance, extra time for troops to rest and prepare rations, and even time for Lee to get his army into proper position, ensuring a systematic, combined and simultaneous attack from all parts of his lines. Some of Lee's officers, especially Longstreet, who had only reluctantly accepted command of the assault force on July 3rd, may have agreed. So too might have officials in Richmond once they read the dispatch that was finally published on July 20th. Conversely, criticism of Meade's generalship on the third day of battle was echoed by Colonel Edward Porter Alexander, a perceptive artillery officer in Longstreet's corps, who, after the war, argued Meade had made a colossal mistake by not organizing a counterattack as soon as the Confederate assault had been repulsed. He also compared Meade's failure to counterattack to that of General George B. McClellan, who was often accused of failing to launch a final decisive late-day attack against Lee's army at Sharpsburg in September 1862. Alexander contended that low levels of ammunition and diminished Confederate forces unwisely dispersed along an extended line meant that an advance by a fresh corps, such as the Sixth Corps, could have cut Lee's army in two. He also suggested Meade should have realized he had nothing to lose and everything to gain by attacking. However, rather than launching a counteroffensive, Meade was more concerned whether Lee might attempt yet another assault. Therefore, while maintaining a defensive posture, the commanding Union general rode to Cemetery Hill to check the situation there. Earlier that morning, Chief Engineer Major General Governor K. Warren and 11th Corps Commander Major General Oliver Otis Howard had informed Meade that they believed rebel movements indicated an intent to attempt to pierce our center. Meade, in turn, requested Major General John Sedgwick to deploy his 6th Corps Reserve Brigades to that area. When he returned from Cemetery Hill, Meade rode south along Cemetery Ridge toward the two round tops. The long ride amounted to a victory lap. Given the unusual spectacle of an AOP commander riding past his troops following a successful encounter with Lee, the cheers and huzzas along the line were so loud they caught Lee's attention on the far side of the field, and he wondered whether it signified a counterattack. The crowning moment of the entire demonstration was when the band located on Little Round Top played an energetic rendition of Hail to the Chief to celebrate. In less than 1 week, the new commanding general had already led the men to a major victory. It would not be the last time Hail to the Chief was played for Meade, nor the last time someone would link his success on the battlefield to the possibility of a Meade presidency. Savannah Republican reporter Alexander also noted that Lee had put his army into motion that very evening, but added, "No enemy pursuit has been attempted, or any demonstration made by either party." Longstreet later recalled, "Orders for retreat were issued before noon of the 4th, and trains of wounded and other impedimenta were put in motion by the Chambersburg and Fairfield routes. The army to march after night by the latter, the Second Corps as rearguard, the first to follow the third, and push on to secure the crossing of the Potomac at Williamsport and Falling Waters." The town awakens joyfully. According to 19-year-old resident Daniel Skelly, it was around midnight that Gettysburg civilians heard a commotion caused by the initial Confederate withdrawal. Officers ordered troops bivouacked on the streets to rise quietly and fall back. By 4 a.m., soldiers in blue were marching down the streets, with the Fife Drum Corps playing and the glorious Stars and Stripes fluttering at the head of the lines. Rebel soldiers left behind were quickly gathered and marched to the rear, while departing Confederates threw up breastworks on the outskirts of town to protect the retreat of their army. Michael Jacobs, another Gettysburg resident and Pennsylvania, now Gettysburg, college professor, noted that all the Confederates had withdrawn from town by 3 a.m. and were behind Seminary Ridge. In fact, he added, "There is sufficient evidence that Lee's retreat began soon after the night of the 3rd had set in, and that he was hurrying his wounded, his stores, his ammunition, and wagon train forward all night and all Saturday, the 4th, by the two roads leading to the Cumberland Valley, the one by the Chambersburg Pike, as far as to Greenwood, and thence towards Waynesboro, and the other directly towards the latter point and Hagerstown." Jacobs believed Lee's escape was a military necessity, and added that virtually the only rebels remaining in the area were multitudes of stragglers, and an even larger number of wounded, emptied out of wagons into farmhouses and barns during the Confederates' hasty retreat. At 3:45 a.m., Brigadier General Adelbert Ames ordered a 12-man detachment from the 17th Connecticut, 11th Corps' 1st Division, to form a skirmish line and move through the meadows at the foot of East Cemetery Hill toward town, feeling for the enemy. The Nutmeg State men moved ahead into a dense fog rising from the damp ground, despite their fear of rebel sharpshooters. The hard-fighting Louisiana Tigers and Hoke's Brigade, led by Colonel Isaac E. Avery, had previously occupied the area, so they advanced under strict silence and communicated by using hand signals until they knew the area was clear. When they reached the line previously held by the enemy, about a half mile from town, no signs of the rebels were found except long grass which had been trampled flat, or the pieces of cracker, an empty canteen, and all the refuse left by a line which had been sleeping on its arms. Once the fog lifted, they recognized the church cupola they had seen just 2 days prior. Spotting an officer waving his hat, the detail quickened its pace and soon learned General Lee had been retreating since 3 o'clock in the morning. That morning, The 4th Pennsylvania Cavalry entered the sleepy town and verified the only rebels remaining were stragglers or wounded. All others were in full retreat towards the sacred soil of Virginia. The 1st New Jersey Cavalry enjoyed a brief period of repose after the arduous 3-day battle, but later that same day was back in the saddle, following up the retreating columns of the enemy. Elsewhere, the 1st Maine Cavalry celebrated the 4th of July by reconnoitering and learning that the enemy had drawn back the left flank. A high price to pay. Both sides had suffered heavily. Almost 8,000 Union and Confederates had been killed, and more than 27,000 wounded during the 3-day cataclysm. Private Albert Corbin, Battery B, 1st New York Light Artillery, rode home while he was caring for wounded Lieutenant Albert Sheldon at the 2nd Corps Hospital. He lamented the death of 10 comrades and the 19 others who had been wounded, and criticized his battery commander, Captain James McKay Rorty, for placing the guns in such an exposed position. Captain John Parsons of the 149th Pennsylvania, from a Gettysburg house that had served as the 1st Louisiana Brigade Hospital, likewise tended to his brigade commander. Colonel Roy Stone had been wounded and captured on July 1st. Parsons observed how confident the rebels were of victory, even with plans to follow with marches on Baltimore, Washington, Philadelphia, and New York. He also noted a drastic change in their attitudes, from high spirits on the evening of July 1st to a much mellower mood after the fight at East Cemetery Hill on the evening of July 2nd. When news of the failure of the grand assaults of July 3rd against Culp's Hill and Cemetery Ridge trickled through the hospital, the prevailing attitude plummeted, and the rebels seemed depressed that evening. This change in mood was Parsons's first intimation of the Union victory. Colonel Joshua Lawrence Chamberlain, whose 20th Maine had heroically defended Little Round Top on July 2nd, spent his morning conducting a reconnaissance of the battlefield, which he described as a scene of insupportable horror. Although told to rest and be ready to move the next day, Chamberlain added, "There was neither removal nor rest for us till we had gone up the Little Round Top slopes to bid farewell to our dead." Chamberlain and the 20th Maine survivors buried their comrades on the side of the hill where they had fought and marked their graves with names carved into ammunition boxes. The scene on the Confederate side of the battlefield and surrounding area was indeed horrific. One Union soldier described the Confederate casualties sprawled along Cemetery Ridge as laying in heaps, with the wounded wriggling and groaning under the weight of the dead among whom they were entangled. A chaplain from the 30th North Carolina, Reverend Alexander Davis Betts, observed that the Corps hospital was moved 3 miles out on the road toward Fairfield. He helped bury 3rd Lieutenant Ira T. Connell of his regiment's Company G, as well as a soldier from the 4th North Carolina. The Union and Confederate wounded engulfed the entire area, turning the town into one vast, overcrowded hospital, with several thousand men lying with amputated arms or legs in tents, fields, woods, stables, and barns. Most were on the ground without any cover or shelter. The grisly nightmare continued for almost 5 months, until mid-November, when President Lincoln traveled to Gettysburg to make a few appropriate remarks for the dedication of the National Cemetery, a permanent resting place for thousands of Union soldiers who gave their last full measure of devotion. It was several years before Confederate bodies would be retrieved from their grave trenches and reinterred in Southern resting places. Defense or offense? An issue that received little attention at the time, but later surfaced during a congressional hearing discussing the Gettysburg Campaign, dealt with whether the AOP should have counterattacked following the defeat of the Confederate assault on July 3rd. Major General Winfield Scott Hancock, the Union 2nd Corps commander in charge of the sector where the rebel attack struck, testified that it was unfortunate that he and Brigadier General John Gibbon were wounded during the assault, because the absence of any prominent commander who knew the circumstances thoroughly proved to be a great disadvantage. "Our lines should have advanced immediately," he opined. "If a counterattack had been made," argued Hancock, "we should have won a great victory." Hancock and Meade had previously discussed the possibility of just such a counterattack. Hancock left the meeting with the impression that Meade would employ the 5th and 6th Corps to attack the enemy's flank. He felt so certain that a counterattack would be made that he instructed Brigadier General John C. Caldwell, who commanded a division in the 2nd Corps, to attack the enemy's flank if the enemy's attack strikes further to your right. Hancock also told Caldwell, "You will find the 5th and 6th Corps on your left, and they will help you." Fortunately for Caldwell's division, he did not order the attack, because neither 5th Corps nor 6th Corps advanced as Hancock had anticipated. Essentially, Hancock, though a trusted and loyal subordinate, expressed concern about Meade's command decisions and an honest disappointment over his missed opportunity to win a great victory and perhaps bring the war to an end. He explained that he had dictated a note to Meade while he was wounded and lying in an ambulance, conveying that if he put 5th and 6th Corps in, they would win a great victory. Later, after Hancock recovered enough to return to the army, he asked Meade why he had not ordered the movement. Meade replied that the troops moved so slowly that nothing was done before nighttime. Major Thomas D. Chamberlain of the 150th Pennsylvania corroborated Hancock's assertion. Wounded and captured on July 1st, Chamberlain witnessed the drastic change in mood by rebels following Pickett's ill-fated attack on July 3rd. He described how they transformed from being confident and exultant to such alarm and confusion that bedlam reigned. He also described how, in panic, Lee's troops rushed to construct breastworks to protect against an anticipated counterattack. In his judgment, if a column of the least engaged Union troops had pushed forward vigorously, resistance would have been short-lived and the rebel lines would have melted away. While conceding that Meade probably knew best under the circumstances, Chamberlain claimed so many retreated that no major effort was made to deliver a crushing blow. Confederate Colonel James P. Sims of Longstreet's Corps echoed Chamberlain, "There was much confusion in our army, so far as my observation extended, and I think we would have made but feeble resistance if Union forces had pressed on the evening of the 3rd. A member of Meade's staff, Major James C. Biddle, defended his commander's decision, arguing that if Meade had yielded to his own inclination to attack, he would have been repulsed and would have thrown away the fruits of his great victory. Meade later testified before the Congressional Joint Committee on the Conduct of the War, JCCW, that he intended to advance on his left after the repulse of Pickett's charge, but a number of factors caused him to abandon the effort, including the great length of the line and the time required to carry these orders out to the front, and the movement subsequently made before the report given to me of the condition of the forces in the front and left caused it to be so late in the evening as to induce me to abandon the assault which I had contemplated. Meade's words indicate he had spent little, if any, time pre-planning a potential counterattack, considering both Hancock's assertions and his own predisposition as Army commander to remain on the defensive. Regarding offensive pursuit, he hesitated to act upon his own initiative, preferring instead to rely upon advice and direction from his subordinates. His hesitation resulted, at least in part, from being only recently appointed to replace Major General Joseph Hooker as commander, but established a pattern. This was Meade's first real opportunity to assume the offensive against Lee's defeated forces, but he chose not to do so. Although Meade had informed Halleck in Washington that there were indications the previous evening that Lee might be withdrawing, he was still not convinced the Confederate Army was in retreat. Early in the day, Meade adopted a guarded approach after receiving a report that cast some doubt about Lee's plans. Brigadier General Francis C. Barlow, commander of the 1st Division of 11th Corps, sent word from inside town that he believed the enemy was not retreating. Barlow had been wounded and captured on July 1st and left behind when the rebels withdrew. Although he did not provide evidence to support his opinion, Meade still attached credence to it. Subsequent events proved Barlow wrong. His captors may have fed him misinformation, a common practice, regarding their intentions. In any event, it bolstered Meade's reluctance to pursue Lee's army and validated a wait-and-see approach. At 6 a.m., Meade's chief of staff, Major General Daniel Butterfield, sent a message to newly...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.